for Melody Ranch and Gene Autry.
I'm back in the saddle again, out where a friend is a friend, where the longhorn cattle feed on the lowly Jimson weed. I'm back in the saddle again.
That's right, folks. It's another visit with all the gang here at Melody Ranch. There's Pat Buttram, the Cass County Boys, the Gene Autry Blue Jeans, Carl Cotner's Melody Ranch Hardway 6, and yours truly, Charlie Lyon. Right now, though, meet the boss man himself, America's favorite cowboy, Gene Autry.
He always sings reggae music to the cattle as he swings back and forward in the saddle on a horse at a syncopated gait, and there's such a funny meter to the roar of his repeater, how they run when they hear the fella's gun, cause the western folks all know he's a highfalutin, shootin', suitin' son of a gun from Arizona, ragtime cowboy Joe.
Out in Arizona where the bad men are, the only thing to guide you is an evening star. The roughest, toughest man by far is ragtime cowboy Joe. He got his name for singing to the cows and sheep. Every night they say he sings the herd to sleep. In a bass so rich and deep, rooting soft and low.
He always sings ragged music to the cattle as he swings back and forward in the saddle on a horse at a syncopated gait, and there's such a funny meter to the roar of his repeater, how they run when they hear the fella's gun, cause the western folks all know he's a highfalutin, shootin', scootin' son of a gun from Arizona, ragtime cowboy.
Talk about your cowboy.
Ragtime cowboys, oh. Well, hello there, everybody, and welcome again to Melody Ranch. You know, there's plenty of parking space outside for your cars and buckboards, and plenty of room in the front parlor for all of our friends and neighbors. You know, one of the songs the boys and girls at Melody Ranch asked me to sing today is a ballad called Slowly I'm Falling More in Love with You. Slowly you're winning a heart that can be true. Now I can't hide my feelings, no matter what I do. For slowly I'm falling more in love with you. More and more I need you and want you by my side. More and more I love you as each day passes by. My heart, I know you're stealing. I hope that you'll be true. For slowly I'm falling more in love with you. Slowly I'm falling more in love with you. Slowly you're winning a heart that can be true. Now I can't hide my feelings, no matter what I do. For slowly I'm falling more in love with you.
Well, thank you, friends. Thank you very, very much. Say, Patrick.
Yeah?
Come over here a minute.
Yeah, what is it, Mr. Artery?
You want to go into town with me for a milkshake?
A milkshake? No, sir, not me, my boy. I'm on a strict diet.
A diet?
Yeah.
Well, this is news.
Yes, sir, I'm really taking off the pounds.
Well, I'm proud of you, Pat.
Yeah.
Because dieting really takes a lot of willpower. Say, when did you first notice that you were putting on weight?
Well, the other day when I put a penny in the scales over in Sagebrush and a little card dropped out that said, stand back, one at a time.
You know, I did notice that you were getting fat in places.
In places? I was fat in places where they ain't even supposing to be places. Why, just walking down the street, I had a feeling that somebody was following me.
Well, I hope you stick to your diet.
Oh, I will. And besides that, I'm taking this here new reducing medicine here.
Oh, reducing medicine?
Yep, got a bottle of it right here. It's called Flaball.
Flaball?
Yep, it really works, too. Looky here. There's a chart right here on the back of the bottle that tells you how much you should weigh for your height and age there.
Mm-hmm. Well, how do you rate?
At my weight, I should be 12 feet tall and 109 years old.
Well, I guess I shouldn't mention this, but I'm a little suspicious of your diet. I don't think you stick to it.
I do so stick to it. Didn't you notice last night I didn't even eat no dinner?
Yeah, but in the middle of the night you raided the icebox and ate everything in it.
Well, when a guy's on a diet, he's got to do something to keep up his strength.
To you, I guess that's logical.
Yes, sirree, Mr. Artery. I know all about diets. There's a friend of mine back home. He went on a diet of nothing but fish.
Fish?
Breakfast, lunch, and dinner. For 2 years, he ate nothing but fish.
How's he doing?
I don't know. I ain't seen him since he went upstream to spawn. You know, but them kind of diets is silly. You should just eat sensible and watch your calories.
Calories?
Yeah, when you get right down to it, fat is all in your head, you know.
And you're the living proof of it, Pat. A real fathead.
Well, thank you.
Don't mention it. But if you really think being fat is a mental problem, why don't you go on a mental diet?
What do you mean, a mental diet?
Well, instead of eating, just imagine your meals.
Do you think it would work?
Well, let's try it. Now, just imagine a great big thick Melody Ranch steak.
Mm-hmm.
Mashed potatoes and gravy.
Yeah.
Black-eyed peas.
Mm-hmm.
Cornbread.
Yeah, lots of that.
Corn on the cob.
Oh, yeah.
A big salad.
Uh-huh.
2 pieces of pie.
Uh-huh.
With ice cream on it.
Uh-huh.
There you are. How do you feel?
Well, don't just stand there. Burp me. So long, Mr. Artery. So long.
So long, Patrick. Well, after that, Cass County boys, see what you and Johnny Bond can do to get me off to a new start.
It's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. It's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer.
Not my brother,
oh no, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer.
Not my sister,
oh no, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. It's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. It's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer.
Not the preacher,
oh no,
but it's me, oh Lord,
standing in the need of prayer.
Not the deacon,
oh no,
but it's me, oh Lord,
standing in the need of prayer. It's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. It's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Not my father, but it's me, oh Lord. Not my mother, but it's me, oh Lord. Standing in the need of prayer,
it's me.
Standing in the need of prayer.
Thank you, Cass County boys and Johnny Bond. You say that I'm unfair, but I've tried hard to do my share. Oh, darling, what more can I do? You don't believe it now, but honest, I've kept every vow. My darling, what more can I do? I've never given you one cause to doubt me. I swear by stars above that I've been true. And though we say goodbye, I'll love you till the day I die. Oh, darling, what more can I do? Each night I pray that with the new day's dawn, you realize that I'm in love with you. By heaven up above,
I've earned the faith that goes with love, my darling. What more can I do?
Well, thank you, friends. Happy to sing it for you.
Mr. Artery.
You back again, Patrick.
What
can I do for you?
Before that last song, Johnny Bond started telling me a story about you and some wild horses. Only he couldn't remember how it went.
Well, I remember all right. I just figured Gene ought to tell it.
Well, all right, get going, boy. Can't have no lull at the parties, you know.
Well, all right, all right. I think Johnny means the time that I worked as foreman for old Chet Simmons, who owned the Circle S up north. One of our biggest troubles on the Circle S was that our best saddle horses was joining the herds of wild mustangs that roamed over the Black Sky Range. All the other ranchers had the same trouble. But one morning, Chet Simmons was really worked up.
Gene? Hey, Gene!
Coming right away, Chet. What seems to be the trouble?
There's plenty. Billy's gone.
Are you sure?
Positive. You know how he always comes running when I whistle. I've run myself plumb out of breath whistling for him. The best horse I ever had, too.
And the most valuable.
Well, all Palomino's is expensive, Gene, but Billy was worth more than money to me. Never thought he'd go traipsing off in a wild mustangs.
I don't see how Billy could have got out.
Well, he did. He's gone, ain't he?
No doubt about that. You know, it seems funny to me that the one horse to get out would be your prized Palomino.
Well, them wild mustangs water at Spider Lake. I'm going up there and see if I can spot Billy.
Well, I wish you luck. Well, Chet Simmons went to Spider Lake and to Mile High Lake, but he didn't see a sign of his prized Palomino. The longer Billy was missing, the madder Chet got. So he was right in the mood to talk business when Red Nelson showed up at the Circle S.
Gene, here's Red Nelson. Red, this is my foreman, Gene Autry.
Aye.
Gene, Red's got a proposition for us.
What kind of a proposition?
Well, Joe Stillwell, head of the Cattlemen's Association, sent him over, he says. Nelson claims he can clear all the wild mustangs off this range.
That'd be quite a trick. How do you plan doing it, Mr. Nelson?
I figure on water traps and blind traps both.
Mm-hmm.
Me and my men had a lot of success around Muroc. Of course, it'll cost you something.
How much?
Your range has mostly scrub stock, and I figure 4 bits a head for the mustangs we catch ain't too bad. Most of the other ranchers already agreed to it.
Well, I don't know about that.
What's the matter, Gene?
Well, it seems to me like this is a part of my job.
If you wait for Autry to clear out the wild mustangs, you'll probably lose more valuable stock, Simmons.
How did you know we lost any stock, Nelson?
Why, everybody's been losing horses to the wild mustang bands.
Oh?
Circle S outfit ain't any exception, is it?
Oh, it sure ain't. I think we ought to let him go ahead, Gene.
Whatever you say, Chet, you're the boss. When do you plan to start, Nelson?
Well, I'm a man who believes in getting things done, Autry. Me and my men will start right away, if it's all right with you.
I've got nothing to say about it. Start whenever you want to. So Nelson and his men rode up into the hills that night and started their roundup. Twice his men showed up at the Circle S, herding a bunch of horses that wore our brand. But Chet's prized Palomino Billy wasn't one of them. A couple of weeks later, when Chet and I were in town on business, we went over to the hotel for lunch. Mr. Baxley, a neighboring rancher, started talking with us about the wild mustangs.
Say, Gene, that Nelson tells me he sent out 2 shipments of them wild mustangs already.
2 shipments, huh? Well, at that rate, there won't be any wild horses left.
I hope you're right. I figure I'll be losing stock till the last of them critters is gone.
You know, George, that Palomino of mine is still missing.
I still think it's funny that he managed to get out.
How long's he been gone, Chet?
About 3 weeks. I reckon our only hope is that Nelson might still run across him.
Well, Nelson's loading stock today. I figured on going down and having a talk with him about some of the other horses. I can ask him about the Palomino, too.
Well, that's a good idea, Gene. Kind of remind him, be on the lookout. I'd come with you, only I still got some things to tend to.
That's all right, Chet. George and I will meet you back here after we've seen Nelson. Well, we went down to the stock pens. A grimy locomotive was moving cars into position when Nelson had his hands full getting the scrubs into the cars. Off to one side in another pen, there was what looked to be about 20 good horses. Mr. Baxley and I started moving over in that direction.
Howdy, boys. Come down to look things over, huh? Well, what do you think of them?
Oh, they're about what I expected, Mr. Nelson. Except the horses in that pen, they look pretty good.
They are good, Autry. And my prophet. You know, a fella's bound to find one or two horses worth breaking amongst the scrubs. You want to take a look at them?
It might be a good idea. What brand are you using on them?
Brand? I ain't using any brand, Autry. They tell me I get better prices back east for unmarked stock. Well, there you are. Three carloads of them.
Three carloads? That don't look like two carloads to me. Aren't you loading them kind of like?
You've been finding fault with my way of doing things since the first day I run across you, Autry. It happens I like loading them light. Anything wrong with it?
Not if you enjoy wasting money. This just isn't the way that most ranchers around here load stock, that's all. George, I just thought of something I forgot to do in town. I've got to be going.
But what about Chet's Falaminio? We're going to ask Nelson about it.
I've changed my mind, George, because I think I know the answer. It seemed to me that those stock cars were loaded mighty light and added up to an ugly picture. So I began to check up. First, I went to see Pop Brennan, the station agent.
Georgie, no three cars are light. Nelson always sends three cars out light every time he ships.
But that's a foolish waste of money. What's the cost of shipping a carload of stock back east?
Oh, these three light cars don't go back east.
Oh, they don't? How far do they go?
Well, according to my way bills, just down the line to the next station.
Baxley was on his way back down the street when I caught up to him.
Oh, hi there, Gene. You must have got that business taken care of fast.
I sure did, George. Say, how many head of good horses have you lost in the last few weeks?
Eight, Gene, and they was good ones, too.
Yeah, they would be.
What are you driving at, Gene?
I haven't time to tell you, George. Just come with me. Well, George was still puzzled when I put in a phone call for Joe Stillwell, the head of the Cattlemen's Association.
Why, no, Gene. I never checked Muroc. Why?
Because Nelson's pulling one of the slickest horse-stealing tricks that's been tried around here in a long time.
If you're right, Gene, the association will back your play.
Good. Meet us at the depot with your boys. Get there quick and be ready for trouble. Well, by the time we all got to the station, there was quite a crowd of us. But Nelson had gotten wind of what was happening before we arrived.
Hurry it up, boys. We gotta get these horses loaded.
Say, Nelson, looks like trouble coming. It's off in those ranchers.
Yeah, you're right. Shut those car doors.
We ain't finished loading.
Forget the rest of the horses. We gotta get this train moving.
Sure, boss. All right, boys, you heard him.
Engineer, get this train moving, and fast, right now.
By the time we got to the stock pens, we could just see the train fading into the distance. It was a slow freight, but even so, with its head start, we had quite a race catching up with it. By the time we caught up with it, most of the horses were pretty tired. Luckily, Champion was still going strong.
We're gaining on him, Gene, but my horse is about through. Doggone it, just when we got a chance of catching Nelson.
Well, you stay with the rest of the men, George, and watch that caboose. I'll handle Nelson. Come on, Champion. Come on, boy. Champ, close to the train. Close to the train, Champ. Engineer! Engineer, stop the train! You're carrying a bunch of horse thieves!
Look out, Gene! There comes Nelson on the catwalk!
Now, Mr. Engineer, you keep that throttle closed. You better duck out of firing range, too.
Engineer! Get this train going unless you want to get hurt bad!
Drop that gun, Nelson.
Yes, again, Autry.
Now walk up here and climb down to the engine cab. You never really thought you could get away with this, did you, Nelson?
Maybe I will yet.
Oh, well, maybe you won't. Maybe I can change your mind.
Now, Nelson, you're going to take us to the stolen horses.
What stolen horses?
The ones you intended to load into these light cars. I've seen the waybills on all three of the cars.
My boys will get you yet, Autry. Help! Use your guns on them, boys!
Why don't you shut up? Don't you know when you're beaten? Joe Stillwell and his boys from the Cattlemen's Association are waiting for you. Look out there.
Yeah? Well, it'll be another time, cowboy. Jet Simmons' ranch was just a Jonah.
Simmons Palomino better be in that bunch of horses you've got there, mister.
Yeah, it's there. You win.
It's fine, Nelson. But I'm afraid you got smart just a little too late.
Hey, that is some story, boss. How'd you first get on to Nelson?
Those light-loaded freight cars with the tip-off, Pat. Nelson didn't want to load more cars than he started out with. So he loaded three cars light. I knew he was going to finish loading them with stolen horses.
Yeah, he was a pretty smart crook, wasn't he?
Well, yes, Pat, as crooks go, Nelson was smart. But the smartest crook in the world is dumb, or he wouldn't be a crook. I'm riding to Tennessee, Tennessee, Tennessee. Because my true love just waits for me in Tennessee. I've saved up a bushel of kisses, saved up a mountain of love. Soon we'll be Mr. and Mrs., closer than a hand in a glove. I'm riding to Tennessee, Tennessee, Tennessee. Because my true love just waits for me in Tennessee.
I've saved up a bushel of kisses, saved up a mountain of love. Soon we'll be Mr. and Mrs., closer than a hand in a glove.
I'm riding to Tennessee, Tennessee, Tennessee. Because my true love just waits for me in Tennessee. In Tennessee. Well, folks, it's time to say so long to our guests and invite everyone to be with us again for another Melody Ranch powwow over these same radio stations. Until then, this is Gene Autry asking you to keep thinking of us.
America's favorite cowboy, Gene Autry, will be back this way next week. And he'll bring along Pat Buttram, the Cass County Boys, the Gene Autry Blue Jeans, Carl Kottner's Melody Ranch Hardway 6, and yours truly, Charlie Lyon. For an exciting and entertaining half hour, be sure you're listening next time I say, it's time for Melody Ranch and Gene Autry.
This is the United States Armed Forces Radio and Television Service.